If you happen to be an intrepid outdoor type who enjoys winter sports like skiing, then you may have been one of the tens of thousands of holidaymakers that found themselves with a little less snow to slide around on in the Alps this season as a result of an extremely unusual winter heatwave that scientists are suggesting is the most extreme event in European history. Some mountain regions reached temperatures of 20 degrees Celsius in December, which is very pleasant if you're sunbathing, but absolutely useless if you want to practice your parallel turns. I imagine it must have been extremely frustrating for those involved, because let's face it, skiing holidays aren't cheap, are they? If you're not an outdoor type and you think that skiing is just an extravagant luxury enjoyed by affluent Westerners, then I imagine you may be suppressing an ironic smirk at the news of all those poor lambs who've not been able to enjoy their expensive Christmas getaway this year. This season's high alpine temperatures were a bit of a freak of nature, to be fair, driven largely by currents of very warm air drifting northwards from the west coast of Africa. But conditions like these are made much more likely by a globally warming atmosphere, so they may well become more commonplace in the future. And that won't just mean a bit of inconvenience for winter sport enthusiasts. It'll start to affect many hundreds of millions of people all over the world. Because as mountain snowfall diminishes in the colder months and temperatures continue to soar in the summer, glaciers all over the world are shrinking at an alarming rate. And those glaciers are in many cases a vital source of fresh water for human communities further down the valley, not to mention innumerable species of flora and fauna that also rely on it for life. So how bad is it, and how much worse could it get? Well, that's a very good question. And in January 2023, a new research paper was published that provides us with the answer. So let's dive in and see what it says. Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. Most of us probably don't spend a great deal of our precious time thinking about glaciers, do we? They're just something hidden away, high up in a remote mountain range, with little or no relevance to our daily lives. But according to a 2019 study published by the online journal Nature, almost 2 billion people all over the world rely directly on mountain glaciers and snowpack as their main source of fresh water supply. In many cases, the seasonal melt also drives hydropower generation and irrigation for agriculture. So that's no less than a quarter of the entire human population who are in deep doo-doo if glaciers disappear. This latest publication is the result of research by teams at various academic institutions led by David Rounce, who is Assistant Professor of Environmental Engineering at Carnegie University in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. The team looked at projected changes in all the world's glaciers, not including the ice sheets in Greenland and Antarctica, based on data from the Shared Socioeconomic Pathways, or SSPs, and Representative Concentration Pathways, or RCPs, published by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or IPCC. Those are the projection charts you often see on the news or on channels like this one that estimate future levels of greenhouse gas emissions depending on how rapidly human societies achieve the transition to a more sustainable way of life and the impacts of those greenhouse emissions on average global surface temperatures over the course of the 21st century. To keep things relatively simple, the team based their calculations on four separate temperature increases. Firstly, the 1.5 degrees Celsius target set out in the Paris Agreement in 2015, and then 2 degrees, 3 degrees, and 4 degrees of warming by 2100. Depending on which pathway our civilization chooses over the next few decades, the world's glaciers are projected to lose anywhere between 26 and 41% of their total combined mass by the end of the century, compared to 2015 measurements. As a reference, the net outcome of all existing national climate policies from countries attending the COP26 climate conference in Glasgow in 2021 is a projected average global temperature rise of 2.7 degrees Celsius compared to pre-industrial levels by the end of the century. That's assuming we actually meet all those policies, of course, which is not something the world is currently on course to achieve. There are more than 200,000 glaciers stretching right around the planet. Some of them are only about a kilometre across, but they nevertheless provide an essential seasonal service to their local habitat. The team found that even in the now vanishingly unlikely event that we managed to keep global temperature rises to only 1.5 degrees Celsius, about 104,000 of those small glaciers would disappear completely. That's pretty much half of all the glaciers on the planet, effectively gone forever. And about 50,000 of them would actually be lost by 2050, less than 30 years from now. If, on the other hand, we manage to stray all the way up to 4 degrees of warming, which is the trajectory our global society is currently following, then we'd be looking at permanent loss of as much as 90% of all glaciers. That'd cause more than 15 centimetres or 6 inches of sea level rise, which would represent about 8% of the total rise under a 4 degree scenario. That's obviously very bad news for the lives and livelihoods of people living in coastal regions around the world. But it's the areas directly dependent upon glaciers that'll suffer the most devastating consequences. We're already seeing some of those consequences happening in real time, right before our eyes. A study published in 2021 by the public university ETH Zurich and the University of Toulouse in France found that the world's glaciers lost nearly 300 billion tonnes of ice every year between 2015 and 2019. That was found to be a 30% increase in the rate of retreat compared to the previous 5 years. Alaska, Iceland and the European Alps are among those already disappearing at an alarming rate. Switzerland's 1,400 glaciers, for example, which represent about 50% of all the ice sheets in the Alps, lost half of their volume between 1931 and 2016. They lost another 12% by 2021, and according to the Swiss Academy of Sciences, during the extreme summer temperatures of 2022, they lost another 6.2%, or 3 cubic kilometres of ice, just in a single season. Now, Switzerland's got quite a bit of cash in the coffers, of course, so while the loss of their glaciers is nothing short of an environmental tragedy, the country will no doubt find a way to adapt and survive. It's not quite such a rosy outlook over in the Himalayas, though. This vast mountain range is home to something like 15,000 glaciers that provide a crucial lifeline to about 500 million people every summer by releasing their meltwaters into the Indus, Ganges and Brahmaputra rivers that flow through Pakistan, India and Bangladesh. When those glaciers go, all three of those countries will experience catastrophic droughts and food shortages. And in the meantime, the vastly increased level of meltwater cascading down the mountains during the hotter months will regularly overwhelm those river systems, causing disastrous levels of flooding like those we witnessed in 2022 in Pakistan as a result of glacial melt from a summer heatwave combining with a monster monsoon season. The countries below the Himalayas don't possess the economic resources of Switzerland, nor do they have well-established and well-organized infrastructure and services that can deal with these kinds of events. The result in Pakistan was that 33 million people were displaced and more than 1,000 people died. And to coin a very hackneyed phrase, you ain't seen nothing yet. The main cause of all this warming and melting is essentially the profligate use of fossil fuels since the start of the Industrial Revolution, releasing massive quantities of carbon dioxide into our atmosphere, which of course is something that Pakistan and the other countries of the global south played very little part in. So I guess it's understandable that there was such fierce debate at COP27 in Sharm el-Sheikh on the subject of loss and damage funding for vulnerable countries who will be hardest hit by climate disasters. That debate did result in a historic agreement by the majority of rich Western nations, eventually even including the United States of America, to create a specific fund to assist developing nations in responding to their loss and damage challenges. Governments also agreed to establish a transitional committee to make recommendations on how to operationalise both the new funding arrangements and the fund itself at COP28 later in 2023, with the first meeting of the Transitional Committee expected to take place before the end of March. But we do also still need to do everything in our power to slow down the warming in an effort to prevent these existential crises happening in the first place. The authors of the Carnegie University paper sum it up quite well. Our projections, they say, reveal a strong linear relationship between global mean temperature increase and glacier mass loss. This strong relationship at global and regional scales highlights that every increase in temperature has significant consequences. The rapidly increasing glacier mass losses as global temperature increases beyond 1.5 degrees Celsius stresses the urgency of establishing more ambitious climate pledges to preserve the glaciers in these mountainous regions. No doubt you've got views and information that you'd like to add to the debate, so if you do, then why not jump down to the comment section below and leave your thoughts there. That's it for this week. Before I go though, I just want to let you know about a new exclusive feature now being enjoyed by the channel's Patreon supporters. For about the price of a coffee each month, you now get exclusive early access to every new video I produce, so you can point out any mistakes I may have made before I publish the final video on YouTube every Sunday. And believe me, there's no shortage of them. You'll also have access to regular additional content available only to Patreon members, and you'll be able to directly influence the topics we talk about via monthly content polls. And while we're about it, I must just give a quick shout out to some folks who joined recently with pledges of $10 or more a month. They are Alex Van Pelt, Dan Nilsson, David Berman, Peter Ehrlich, Andrew Shannon, Jeremy Smithson, Matthias Wahlberg, Daniel Katz, Alison Leduc, Will Walker, and James Hatcher. And of course, a big thank you to everyone else who's joined since last time too. If you found this video useful and informative, then make sure you subscribe by clicking down there or on that icon there. And don't forget to hit the notification bell too, so you can keep up to date with future content. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.